In this video, we will review the gross anatomy of the heart. The heart's primary function is to circulate blood around the body, and the cardiac structure enables it to fulfill this function. This whole process of coordinated cardiac contraction is mediated by the conduction system of the heart. Looking at the heart within the thoracic cavity, note the intercostal spaces as shown here. When the heart beats, the apex is palpable along the midclavicular line at the fifth intercostal space. When looking at the heart, it is important to note the different surfaces. Inferiorly is the diaphragmatic surface, as it is in contact with the diaphragm. Laterally is the left pulmonary surface, which is in contact with the left lung. Posteriorly is the base of the heart, and this is the right pulmonary surface. And lastly, the anterior surface of the heart. Looking at the anterior and posterior aspects of the heart, note the following structures. This area here is formed by the right atrium. The anterior and inferior aspect of the heart are largely formed by the right ventricle. The base of the heart is largely formed by the left atrium. And the lateral aspect of the heart is formed by the left ventricle. This is the superior and inferior vena cava, which carries systemic deoxygenated blood to the right atrium. This blood then moves into the right ventricle to be sent to the lungs via the pulmonary trunk. Oxygenated blood from the lungs then enters the left atrium via the pulmonary veins marked here. And blood moves to the left ventricle and enters the systemic circulation via the aorta. Note here the right auricle, which overlies the right atrium, and the left auricle over the left atrium. An interior look will reveal the heart has four chambers: the right atrium, right ventricle, left atrium, and left ventricle. The atrium and ventricles are separated by valves. The tricuspid valve on the right and the mitral valve, a bicuspid valve on the left. Separating the chambers is a septum. In the right atrium, you'll observe the openings for the superior and inferior vena cava and the fossa ovalis, which is where the foramen ovale once was and closed after birth. The atrium wall is lined by pectinate muscle, which has a tooth-combed appearance due to horizontal muscle ridges. Separating the right atrium and ventricle is the tricuspid valve, which has three cusps. These cusps are attached to the papillary muscles via the cordae tendineae. The papillary muscles ensure the valves remain closed during systole to prevent backflow of blood into the atria during ventricular contraction. In the left atrium, there are openings for the pulmonary veins. Separating the atrium and the ventricle is the mitral valve, which is a bicuspid valve. In this view, one can appreciate the semilunar valves of the pulmonary and aortic valve. Note the irregular muscle ridges of the ventricles, known as trabeculae carinae. We will now provide a simplified overview of the coronary circulation. Note that the left and right coronary arteries come from the base of the aorta. Here's the left coronary artery, which runs along the coronary sulcus. The branches of the left coronary artery include the left circumflex, which supplies the lateral aspect of the heart, and the left anterior descending artery. It has septal and diagonal branches. The left circumflex extends posteriorly and supplies the posterior lateral aspect of the heart. The right coronary artery forms the right marginal artery, which supplies the anterior and diaphragmatic surface of the right ventricle. The right coronary artery can also extend posteriorly to supply the posterior aspect of the heart and form the posterior descending artery. Coronary dominance refers to which artery dominates in supplying the posterior aspect of the heart, and that is largely determined by which artery forms the posterior descending artery. It can either be left, right, or co-dominant. Consider the clinical relevance of this. If the left circumflex artery is occluded, this causes a lateral infarct. If a branch of the left anterior descending is completely occluded, there'll be a septal infarct. And if there's proximal occlusion of the left anterior descending artery, there'll be an anterior septal infarct.